She has not been able to work and will require the support of the defendant in the form of spousal support and child support. She and the minor child have no other place to go except for the marital home, but due to her inability to work, she is in need of the financial support of defendant to continue to pay the bills associated with the marital home, including but not limited to the mortgage, taxes, insurance, utilities, and other necessities of life, such as gas, groceries.
She states that she has no money, but she spent $400, over $400, to change the lock on the property, and she put over $800 in cameras up.
Dad was escorted off his own property.
Tiffany Osborne versus Shane Osborne.
Court will note the appearance of Ms. Podolsky on behalf of plaintiff, Ms. Bailey Hobbs on behalf of defendant. This matter is before the court on the plaintiff's motion for temporary custody, parenting time support, spousal support, and exclusive use of the home. Ms. Podolsky.
Thank you, Your Honor. As the court is aware, there is a companion case in this court, case number 2024-462-PP. That is the personal protection order that plaintiff has against the defendant. Unfortunately, this marriage has a long history of both domestic violence and emotional abuse by defendant perpetrated on the plaintiff. The most recent occurring on January 31st, 2024, wherein the plaintiff was physically assaulted and was transported to Oak Lawn Hospital. And that is what necessitated the ultimate filing of divorce in this PPO. The parties have one minor child and one child who recently became an adult. The minor child was present during this most recent assault, and both children have been present throughout the numerous emotional screaming and shouting and berating, the swearing, the horrific name calling, the abuse. They've been present throughout the marriage. We have both video and audio recordings of defendant when he loses control like this. My client has been a stay-at-home parent throughout the marriage. She is currently working with attorney Jim Hodzma to obtain Social Security disability. She is doing this due to full spinal stenosis and sciatica, as well as other health complications. Because of this, she has not been able to work and will require the support of the defendant in the form of spousal support and child support. With the PPO in place, my client has been residing in the marital home. She and the minor child have no other place to go except for the marital home. But due to her inability to work, she is in need of the financial support of defendant to continue to pay the bills associated with the marital home, including but not limited to the mortgage, taxes, insurance, utilities, and other necessities of life, such as gas, groceries, and things for the minor child. There is a bond between mother and child. They have always lived together since birth. She has been the primary caretaker of the minor child since birth. We have significant concerns because the minor child has been present during these instances where the defendant is committing the domestic violence, the emotional abuse on the plaintiff. We believe that it would be important for the minor child to get into counseling to deal with what she has seen, the trauma that she has seen going on in this household. And we believe it is important now for the plaintiff to be awarded the sole physical and legal custody of the minor child with reasonable parenting time for the defendant. We would leave it to the court's discretion whether that should be supervised at this time in light of the abuse and the current PPO. But we also believe then support consistent with the Michigan Child Support formula should be awarded as well.
Ms. Podolsky, I'm looking at your petition and all you've stated for any income for the defendant is defendant has been employed full-time during the entirety of the marriage, owns and profits from rental property, and does construction for various businesses under the table. Court has no idea what his income is to be able to determine whether spousal support or anything else would be appropriate. How am I to guess at that?
Well, Your Honor, that is something that my client has had to do throughout the marriage as well. He has been self-employed. They have one rental that earns $750 per month. He works in construction. He is not employed by a business that we would be able to subpoena information from. He is self-employed. We believe it would be necessary to impute income because we're not able to obtain an actual pay stub for him. We believe in this trade locally, he could earn $20 to $30 an hour in that job as a self-employed construction worker.
So there are clearly quite a few issues that need to be addressed in this case. First, plaintiff filed a petition for personal protection order on the same date that she signed her complaint for divorce. That doesn't seem like a coincidence. In fact, her petition for personal protection order was filed on February 16th, 2024. She made contact with the Calhoun County Sheriff's Office on February 15th, the day before she signed her complaint for divorce and filed the petition for personal protection order. And she asked about serving a PPO and the eviction process. She's made false allegations that my client severely physically assaulted her in order to obtain that personal protection order and gain exclusive use of the home without going through the proper channels with this court. Therefore, she has gained an advantage in this divorce action. She has been in possession of the home for almost a month. My client has been unable to work since he was served with the PPO and escorted off of his own property. He's self-employed as a general contractor. His business is located on the property of the marital residence. He cannot work if he does not have access to his shop. That's where all of his tools are. Say the court granted plaintiff exclusive use of the home and then said, defendant, you can put all your tools in your truck. Well, that's not an efficient way to work. He's a general contractor. He would have to unload all of his tools to find the tool that he needed to do his job and then reload all of them back. He has asked, he's asked his daughter who was at the property to allow him to get some of his clothes. He has nothing. She's not allowed to give him any clothes. She's not been allowing him to have any of his tools. And yet she claims that she's desperately dependent upon his income. I just don't see the point in being that desperate to have him pay everything for her, but then refusing to let him make his income. She states that she has no money, but she spent over $400 to change the locks on the property. And she put over $800 in cameras up. She's using the personal protection order to launch an assault against my client with the goal of having him incarcerated. This will be covered more in our motion to terminate, which is later today. But the court does need to know what we're dealing with. It was brought to my attention very early this morning by a trooper with the Michigan State Police that plaintiff filed a report indicating Mr. Osborne broke into the home and stole firearms. She filed this report on the 14th, which was last Thursday, and the Michigan State Police are investigating that report as a false police report having been made. Should this court want to set this for an evidentiary hearing, we will call the trooper that I spoke with this morning and give that information to the court as well. Plaintiff is requesting primary physical and sole legal custody on a temporary basis. That is absolutely not in the best interest of the minor child. The marriage has been tumultuous at times. However, plaintiff is mischaracterizing all of the recent facts in this case, and she's done everything she can to set it up to where it looks like it's in her favor. The minor child is in the home with her mother, witnessing and being present for all of the false allegations that plaintiff is currently making. All of the police that are coming to the home and questioning everybody. The child is not allowed to see her father. Plaintiff also moved her father into the home. And there are multiple men coming and going in and out of the home. The child is scared. She wants to be with her father. To address plaintiff's allegation that the minor child was at the home on the incident that occurred on January 30th, or at least the incident that plaintiff mother is saying occurred so that she could gain her advantage in this case. Both children told the police officers that they didn't see anything. In fact, they tried to warn their dad that mom was on the way. She was on a rampage.
Hey, Ms. Bailey Hobbs, I'm not addressing the PPO now. Please move on or we're never going to get done.
I understand, Your Honor. I'm just saying that...
I'm just saying move on.
Okay. The issue is that Ms. Podolsky is indicating that the children were home when that happened. And that should be a reason that this court should not allow defendant father to have parenting time, or if the court does, that the court should make that supervised. It is our position, based on the facts that are in front of this court today, that is not necessary. I have nothing further, Your Honor.
Anything? Okay. Well, in this particular matter, court does note that, as stated by Ms. Bailey Hobbs, that in fact the child is in the care of the plaintiff. The court notes in paragraph 3 of her answer, she states as well that the child lives with the plaintiff. And paragraph 5 states, defendant father further states that he does not have a residence. As a result, in this matter, the court is going to award to the plaintiff temporary physical and legal custody. Court will allow the defendant to have standard parenting time. We have no income on which to base support, so the court will impute $15 per hour of full-time income. The court will grant to the plaintiff exclusive use of the house during the pendency of this matter. The court will order that the defendant would pay the mortgage, taxes, insurance during the pendency of this matter or until further order the court. The court will further order that the defendant shall have a right to get all of his tools and clothing from the home on March 16, 2024 at 12 o'clock noon. Court was ordered that the plaintiff not be present from 11:30 a.m. until such time as the defendant has taken all of his tools and left in this matter, that she can have a third party present to supervise, et cetera, but she shall not be present. So we don't have any issues concerning the PPO because we're not addressing that until later today. So Ms. Podolsky, I'll ask that you would prepare that order. I'm not granting any spousal support at this time as I don't have any additional information concerning income. And the court does note that there was none and I'm imputing it, but we don't know if there's anything else. We'll address that at the time that we have accurate information.
Your Honor, you said he could come in March 16th. Did you mean March 20th this Saturday?
March 20th is not this Saturday.
Oh, or not March 20th, I'm sorry. March
20th. Yes, yeah. I'm sorry, March 22nd. I was looking at the week behind. So it's March 23rd, I'm sorry. March 23rd, 2024. He can pick up all of his tools and clothing.
Okay, perfect. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor.
And we're asking that this court require the defendant to vacate the marital home forthwith and that any necessary parenting exchanges, he come back for that and not for other reasons.
While the real estate was the plaintiff's premarital property, it is now in the name of both parties. It has been mortgaged and there's been significant work done to the home during the marriage, not just the kitchen renovation that my client has been working on.